In the second half, Frank Rijkaard strived to add pep to the Dutch attack. Then a Dane suffered the most grotesque of injuries. In the semi-finals, an unfortunate thing happened for us when Henrik Andersen incurred a very nasty and serious injury to one of his knees. It was what I would call an unfortunate collision with a Dutch player. And the unfortunate thing was that he crushed his kneecap.
Danish hopes of reaching an historic championship final still remained high as their supporters whistled optimistically for full time. Then, with barely 5 minutes left on the clock, Holland were awarded a corner that fell at the feet of Frank Rijkaard, the consummate professional. Rijkaard had been at the very top for a long time now. He'd won almost every honour the game had to offer, and he could certainly recognise a scoring opportunity, however unlikely it may appear to others less instinctive. Two goals each, extra time. Then, with no further goals added to the scoreboard, the match moved into the drama of a penalty shootout. A Dutch score. A Danish reply. Then came Van Basten, and Schmeichel found a miracle. Marco Van Basten, the goal scorer supreme, had missed from the spot.
There was something quite special about the winning penalty kick. It was the way Kim Kristoff took that last penalty kick. He was in the position, so he decided everything. Kim had frequently taken some very important penalties for his club team Brøndby, for whom he played at the time. He has always been very confident with them. I felt a calmness because it was him doing the kicking.
Danes prepared. Win or lose, they had arrived in Sweden also-rounds and had ended their stay as finalists against the reunited German nation.
Det er klart, at en sådan finale, som vi spillede mod Tyskland, den...
A final match, such as the one we played against Germany, will remain impressed upon my memory until the end of my life. For us, it was an enormously difficult match. The Germans had had a rest day more than us. We had suffered many injuries, and they could come to the game fresher, having enjoyed a good period of preparation.
The game began in a rather robust fashion. It would finish the same way. Thankfully, the referee kept a tight rein over all the obvious flashpoints, yet quite wisely also allowed the football to flow. Then, in the 18th minute, a cross found John Jensen lurking behind the German line, and he let fly with a missile that exploded across the continent of Europe. The Danes had actually taken the lead against the Germans. Terrace support had become vital to Denmark's progress so far, and Schmeichel had no intention of allowing the volume to fade. Trailing by a single goal, the Germans swung into action as they had in times past, but found Schmeichel impassable. The whole Danish team appeared now to have acquired an aura of invincibility. They knew they would not be beaten, and more importantly, the Germans seemed to know as well. Brian Laudrup remained a fly in the ointment of German opposition. His close control gnawed at the German midfield, while his eye for the pass allowed his teammates the space in which to play. The Germans seemed aggravated by their lack of success, and even little Hassler received yellow from the referee. In the second half, the German attacks were broken up. The Danish players pushed tired limbs towards seizure, and the German players continued with their petulance. Perhaps it was because of Denmark's high-profile performances during the 1986 World Cup finals in Mexico that the old adage, out of tiny acorns, mighty oaks may grow, seemed appropriately coined here in Sweden on the 26th of July, 1992. In this furnace of excitement, a player was capable of turning from a mortal man into a giant with a single kick. In attack. In defense. Across the whole spectrum of the game. Then it happened. A nod forward from midfield, a kind bounce, a suspicion of handball, an unsighted official. Denmark had secured a fantastic championship victory.
Germany was an extremely difficult opponent for us, but in the end it worked out, and it was of course a great relief when Kim Vilfort scored goal number two in the second half. We knew then that we were in with a chance. We could bear the injury time before the referee's final whistle. The last precise whistle at the end is one of the things I remember best. Then it was all marvelous. We ran around the pitch and said thank you as well as we could to the Danish supporters. Then there was the amazing fireworks in the middle of the pitch, where a giant football opened to let out brilliant fireworks into the sky. It was certainly an evening not many Danes will forget.
Perhaps because of the hideous carnage being perpetrated in war-torn Yugoslavia, it was appropriate that their joyful Danish replacement should be lifting the Delaunay Cup.